Hello viewers, today we shall be dealing with another important aspect of transfer and transmission of shares. This is Part-1G of the Unit 4th of the Company Law portion. Now, let us try to know this term, what is a transfer and what is a transmission under Section 82. The general provisions regarding the transfer are that the shares are a movable property, that is, they are considered as goods. Even if we refer to the Sale of Goods Act, the shares have been included in the definition of goods. The shares shall be transferable in the manner specified in the Act and the articles under Section 82. Now, the specific provision under the Companies Act, that is Section 111A, the shares in the public company are freely transferable. That means there are no restrictions which have been imposed on the public company regarding transfer of the shares. A private company, however, can impose reasonable restrictions on transferability of shares. However, a private company cannot impose absolute restriction of the shares. There is only restriction on the transfer of the shares, but it cannot stop the transfer of the shares. It can impose certain conditions relating to whom the transfer of the shares can be made. Transfer means a voluntary transfer of the shares from one person to another. So here operates the will of the person while transferring the shares from one person to the other. There is no operation of law in this regard. Whereas in the case of transmission, the transfer of ownership of share takes place from one person to another by the operation of law. It could be the operation of the Insolvency Act or the law of succession. Now, what are the requirements related to the transfer of the shares under Section 108? The application for transfer of shares must be made in the form prescribed for this purpose. The form is called Form 2A in this regard. This form is called as the instrument of transfer or the transfer deed or the transfer form or the share transfer form. So it can be described variously, but it is actually a contract between the party which is transferring, called as the transferor, and the party to whom the transfer is being made, called as the transferee. Now, another requirement is after executing the transfer deed, then the presentation has to be made to the prescribed authority. The various conditions required are that every transfer deed shall be presented to the prescribed authority, that is the registrar. The transfer deed shall be presented before it is signed by the transferor and before any entry is made therein. So whenever the transfer has to take place, those adequate number of transfer deeds have to be obtained from the registrar of the company, and then only it shall be duly filled according to the requirements of the Act. The prescribed authority, that is the registrar, shall affix on the transfer deed a stamp showing the date of presentation of the transfer deed. Now we will be discussing the aspect relating to the execution of the transfer deed. After the transfer deed has been stamped by the prescribed authority, that is the registrar of the companies, it shall be duly filled up by the transferor and the transferee. It will be duly signed by the transferor and also the transferee. And also it will be duly stamped, that is, stamp duty will be paid according to the State Stamp Act in which the transfer is taking place. Now, after all these compliances have been done, then the transfer deed is submitted to the company under Section 110. The transfer deed may be presented to the company either by the transferor or by the transferee. The transfer deed shall be presented to the company along with the share certificate. Now, these requirements are only related to the physical holding of the shares. When the shares have been held in physical form through the share certificate showing how many shares is held by the share transferor, then only all these compliances shall be made. In case they have been held in the dematerialized form, that is with a depository, then no such compliance relating to the signing, relating to the stamping shall be done. Now, what is the time limit for the submission of transfer deed of the company? The transfer deed shall be valid only if it is delivered to the company within the following time period. For a listed company, it will be the later of, that is the date on which the register of the member is closed for the first time after the stamping of the transfer, or 12 months from the date of stamping of the deed. In case it is any other company which is not listed, then it shall be done within 2 months from the date of the stamping. Now, provision relating to the notice by the company to the transferee. After the transfer deed has been lodged with the company is required to give the notice to the transferee only both the following conditions are satisfied. The first one is the transfer deed is presented to the company by the transferor and the shares are not fully paid up. Regarding these two conditions, the transferee has the right to object to the proposed transfer within a period of 2 weeks. In case he has not objected to the transfer within a period of 2 weeks, the transfer shall be noted in his name. The few common grounds for the refusal to transfer the shares in the private company. Like we discussed earlier, a private company can also allow the transfer of the shares, but after imposing certain restrictions. Now, these restrictions may pertain to the following conditions which have been given over here. The first one is the malified object. In case the company senses certain malified objects regarding the transfer of the share, it can impose a restriction and refuse to transfer the share. The second one is the transferee being a rival. In case a rival company wants to obtain the shares through another transferor of the company who is a member, then also the company can refuse such a transfer. The third one is the transfer being indebted to the company. In case any debt is held by a member with a company, then lien will be exercised by the company so that the shares will not be transferred in any other name. If there is apprehended mismanagement and the shares are devolving or the shares are going into the hand of another person who will not conduct the management of the company properly, then also the transfer shall be restricted. In case the transferee is incapable of paying the calls, then also the transfer shall be restricted. If the company knows that the shares are going into the hands of a minor, the transfer shall be objected. The transfer, if it is prejudicial to the company's interest and is not bona fide, then also the transfer shall be refused. In case the transfer deed is not fully filled up or it is invalid, then also the transfer shall be refused. Then is offer to the existing shareholders. It can also ask the transferor to offer the shares to the existing shareholders so that no outsider obtains the shares of the private company. And then the last one is employees who are leaving the employment. The current employees who are leaving the organization and they hold the shares of the company, the private company can ask them to transfer the shares in favor of the existing shareholders of the company rather than they taking the shares with them or transferring it to some outsider. Now we will be discussing about another aspect of the public company, that is transfer and transmission of shares in the public company according under section 111A. The shares are freely transferable in the public company, but there could be instances where the transfer could be refused. The refusal could be justified only if there is a sufficient cause which means there could be a situation where the proposed transfer of share is in contravention of certain acts. The first one being the Securities and Exchange Board of India 1992, that is the SEBI Act. Second is the guidelines which have been issued under the same act, that is the SEBI Act 1992. The third one is the CECA, that is the SIC Industrial Companies Act. Any other law which is there in the time being force in India. Nomination of shares. Nomination of shares under section 109A and 109B. Nomination means submitting with the company the name of the family members or close persons who shall be entitled to the shares in case the member is deceased. Now, for all the companies, nomination is optional, and this section applies both to the private company and to the public company. Every member who is an individual can make a nomination. So, the facility of nomination is not available to another company, to an HUF, to a partnership firm, because nomination can be done only by an individual in favor of his family and friends. Two or more persons who are individuals can be jointly made nominees by a nomination form which can be filed by the member any time after he becomes the member of the company. A minor could be named as a nominee provided the name of the guardian is also mentioned in the nomination form. Nomination can be made in the prescribed form and manner according to the Companies Act regulations. Nomination can be made at any time and it can also be altered any time. Now, we will discuss about the rights of the nominee. The shares shall vest in the nominee after the death of the member. So, a nominee shall not be entitled to the share during the lifetime of the member. It is only after the death that he shall be entitled to the shares which has been held as a nominee in his name. The nomination shall be valid and it shall be effectual. An application which is signed by the nominee and a death certificate of the deceased member shall be submitted to the company. The application shall state that the nominee has elected to become a member of the company. A transfer deed which is signed by the nominee and a death certificate of the deceased member shall be submitted to the company. The transfer deed signed by the nominee shall be valid even though he is not a registered shareholder, but shall not exercise his voting right in the general meeting until he is registered. So, there is an option which is given to the nominee regarding him becoming a member. In case he chooses to become a member, he has to submit the death certificate and also a signed transfer deed to register him as a member of the company. This transfer deed is valid even though he is not actually become the member of the company, and he can also transfer the shares in somebody else's name as well. Now, another term which is called as transmission, which happens only on the operation of law. The provisions have been discussed under section 109. Transmission means the passing of title of a person to another person by operation of law. Where the shares are held jointly by two or more persons, transmission shall take place only when all the joint holders die. So, jointly held shares, it is necessary for the law of succession to operate and the shares to be transferred to the legal heir only when the joint shareholders are no more in this world. Then the transmission takes place only at the time of the death or at the time of insolvency of a member. A person who is entitled to the shares as a consequence of death or insolvency of a member does not automatically become a member of the company. This is in regard that he has to submit certain documents regarding proving his claim over the shares, even though he is the legal heir or he is the official receiver. He will become the member only when he makes an application in writing to the company and the company registers him as a member of the company, making an entry in the register of members. The person entitled to the shares is required to make an application in writing to the company, requesting the company to admit him as a member. No transfer deed is required in such case. Even if he chooses to sell the shares without first becoming a member, he is required to execute a transfer deed. The transfer deed signed by him shall be valid for transfer of such shares, even though he is not a member in relation to such shares. On the occurrence of the death of the member, then the legal heir has to make an application to the company, and also he is required to submit the death certificate of the deceased member. On making such an option, then the legal heir shall become the member of the company and the shares shall be transferred in his name. If he chooses to sell the shares of the company, then he is required to also execute a transfer deed. But while claiming for the shares, he is not required to submit a transfer deed. Such a transfer deed which has been executed to transfer the shares in somebody else's name do not require the signature of the deceased member. Now, certain points of distinction between the transfer and transmission. Transmission is not a voluntary act because it happens only on the operation of the law, that is the law of succession or the insolvency act. Whereas the transfer is a voluntary act, only the party which wants to transfer the shares exercises its will. Then is the execution of the transfer deed. In the case of transfer, execution of transfer deed is a must, whereas in transmission, there is no exercising of execution of the transfer deed. Because of the operation of law, the filing of the transfer deed is not required. Then is payment of stamp duty. When the transfer deed is to be executed by the transferor, then the stamp duty also has to be paid on it. Here it will be appropriate to point out that in case the shares have been held in the depository, that is in the dematerialized form, then there is no requirement of payment of the stamp duty or execution of the transfer deed. Then is the consideration. There shall not be any exchange of consideration in case it is a transmission of shares, because there is no sale occurring or there is no voluntary transfer which is occurring. So consideration shall not be paid in the case of transmission, whereas in the case of transfer, the consideration shall be paid, a contract note and a transfer deed shall be executed and submitted with the company. Then is the certification of transfer, which requires splitting of shares, partial transfer of shares according to section 112. There could be an instance where the transfer wants to transfer the shares not just to one transferee but to a number of persons, maybe two or more than two. So when he intends to do it, it cannot be validly done through one transfer deed or the filing of the share certificate, because the share certificate cannot be broken. It only indicates the total number of shares held by the individual. So in such a case, the shareholder shall be submitting to the company the transfer deed and the share certificate. On receipt of the transfer deed and share certificate from the member of the company, from the member, the company shall adopt the following procedure. The company shall return the share certificate. The company shall make a certification on the transfer deed. The certification is generally made by writing the words certificate lodged or certificate deposited or any other similar words. The company shall return the share transfer deed after certification to the member. The certification shall be prima facie evidence that the shareholder has submitted the share certificate to the company and the share certificate contained such number of shares as are specified in the certified transfer deed. So when the shareholder wants to transfer the balance shares to another person, then the company issues him the balance tickets which have the fact of the balance shares which the shareholder is entitled to. But actual and original share certificate shall lie with the company and the transfer deed shall be behaving as the share certificate only. Then another aspect related to the transfer is the forged transfer. Let us know that the forgery does not give rise to a valid contract. It is an act in nullity. So the meaning of the forged transfer means a transfer which is made on the basis of a transfer deed on which the transferor's signature are forged. A forged transfer deed is a nullity and without any legal effect. The transferee does not become the owner of such shares. The original owner continues to be the shareholder. Where a company has registered the transferee as a shareholder on the basis of a forged transfer, the following consequences shall follow. The original owner can compel the company to restore his name on the register of members because the actual transfer has not taken place. Hence, the original member names shall be restored back into the register of member. The company may also cancel the share certificate which has been issued to the transferee, and consequently the transferee shall cease to be the member of the company. Where the transferee has already transferred the shares to an innocent purchaser, the position will be as follows. The company shall refuse to register the new purchaser of shares as a member. However, the new purchaser of shares shall have a right to claim damages from the company, and consequently the company shall have the right to recover the damages from the person who had lodged the forged transfer deed. Hence, the name of the original member shall be restored back. The transferee who is bona fide and has purchased the shares from the transferee who has forged the document, he shall be compensated for the damages, and the company can claim back the damages from the forged transferor. Another aspect related to the transfer is the blank transfer. A transfer is said to be blank if it contains the signature of the transferor, but it does not contain the particulars relating to the transferee. The transferor shall deliver to the buyer the share certificate and the blank transfer deed. The buyer does not automatically become the owner of the instrument on receipt of the share certificate and the blank transfer deed. So, it is a kind of authority that the transferor has given to the transferee by not filling all his details so that he can himself fill his detail and lodge it with the company. When the buyer gets such an implied authority to complete the transfer deed, he shall become the owner of the shares only when he completes the blanks in the blank transfer deed. He delivers the share certificates and duly filled in transfer deed to the company for effecting transfer of shares in his name, and the company registers the transfer of shares in the name of the buyer. When the name of the buyer is registered as a shareholder by the company, he shall acquire a good title to the shares, notwithstanding the fact that the shares were transferred to him under a blank transfer deed. In this case of a blank transfer, there could be multiple transfers without having one to pay the stamp duty in this regard. because when a transfer has to take place between say A to B, B to C, and there is a chain of transfers taking, every time the transfer deed is executed and lodged with the company, a separate stamp duty has to be paid on the amount of consideration exchanged by the parties. But when there is a blank transfer, then the consideration and then the stamp duty according to the consideration shall not be required to be paid until and unless the person who is the last transferee wants to get the shares registered in his name. So, in this regard, the stamp duty shall be paid only by the last transferee of the share who has lodged all the valid documents to the company. So, the buyer who does not intend to become the owner of the shares and wants to further transfer the shares, he may do so by merely delivering the share certificate and blank transfer deed to the new buyer. Similarly, the new buyer has the same two options, that is to become the owner of the shares or to transfer such shares to another new buyer. The last holder of the blank transfer deed will become the transferee of the shares, and no intervening buyer of shares shall be regarded as a transferee. Until some buyer is registered as a shareholder, the original holder of the shares, that is the transferor, shall continue to be the owner of the shares. A blank transfer deed shall remain valid only for such period as it has been prescribed under Section 108. With this, we are concluding our today's session. In our session today, we had discussed various terms related to the transfer and transmission. We also discussed the differences between the transfer and transmission, who all can transfer the shares, and what are the parties and circumstances in the case of transmission of shares. We also discussed terms related to transfer, like the blank transfer, the forced transfer, and certification of the transfer deed. I hope you enjoyed the session. Thank you.